Good morning. Today is Sunday, September the 27th of 2020, and I say welcome to Potomac United Methodist Church and our virtual worship. I'm Pastor Laura. A few things I'd like to share with you this morning before we get started into the sermon. The first is that following worship today at 11 o'clock will be the next conversation about faith and the arts. And so if you haven't connected into that yet, you are more than welcome. 16 people connected last week, and it was a wonderful conversation. I'm hoping you received our blast in the last couple of days. Maybe it went out on Wednesday or Thursday this past week. Our blast is just our way of saying we're thinking about you and here are some things that we'd like you to know. If you do not receive the blast, please just hit us up with your email and we're happy to add you to the list. This week, we were blessed in our church office at the Parish Center by an amazing work of art done by one of our own, Nadine Ellers. So about 3 years ago, I asked Nadine if she would do a piece for the office, and around the theme of what does faith mean to her, she brought it this week, and it's breathtaking and it's heartfelt, and so that's in the blast this week. We had an amazing church council meeting, and at the end of it, Susan Barrett prayed this amazing prayer, and we put that in the same blast. The third thing we put was a lovely video from Italy. Somebody put it up on YouTube, and Steve Edwards sent it to me and to a number of you, and we wanted everybody to share it. So it's a wedding in Italy, and the groom is an opera singer. And so he begins this song to his bride, and then members of his choral group, socially distanced, stand up in the sanctuary and join. And it's just we just wanted to lift your hearts this week, so I hope that we accomplished that. This Friday, which is going to be October 2nd, if you can stand that, we're going to have a date night. We're going to have a date night for families and for anybody who wants to come in our church parking lot. We are arranging to have an outdoor screen. We're going to be showing a Pixar movie. And it is BYOC, bring your own chair. Some of you, we're gonna socially distance, so we'll have areas marked off for you to sit in your chairs as families. We're also gonna make space for people who might wanna sit in their cars and watch the movie. But we're gonna have some opportunity to shout out to one another. 7:30 this Friday, come on and join us. As this week has progressed, it's been harder and harder for me to imagine that next Sunday is Worldwide Communion Sunday, the Sunday when we remember our baptismal vow and our covenant with God and with one another and share with Christians all around the world in the bread and cup. So come to worship next Sunday, prepared for Worldwide Communion Sunday.
And loving heart.
We are inviting anybody who might want to record one of the scriptures for Sunday worship to be in touch with us. This Sunday, nobody signed up, so I'm going to share the scripture with you. And I'm really just going to share one passage. It's what has taken my imagination and my heart of faith into deep thought this week, and so I want to share it with you. It's from the book of Exodus, which is the second book of the Bible, of the Hebrew Bible, and it's from the 17th chapter. It's verses 1 through 7. So hear now this story. This is a story of Moses leading the people beyond the parting of the Red Sea. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages as God commanded them. They stopped at Rephidim to camp, but there was no water for the people to drink. So the people quarreled with Moses and said to him, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why are you quarreling with me? Why do you continue to test God?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the more they thirsted, the deeper their thirst, the more the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us, our children and our livestock, with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I going to do with your people? They're almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you parted the Red Sea and struck the Nile, and go. And I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at Sinai. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And as they moved on from that place, Moses called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites had quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is God among us or not?" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In 1977, a movie called Oh God hit the theaters. It was directed by Carl Reiner, and it starred John Denver in the role of a grocery store clerk assistant manager, who was chosen by God to spread the word that God still was interested in the people, and that God's greatest desire for humankind was that we might love one another. George Burns, you might remember, played God. Now, I imagine I went to see this movie the first time because as a teenager, I had a terrible crush on John Denver. Don't judge me. But I returned to see it many times because I loved the idea that God could just show up and be. It's an idea that still gives me pause. I mean, you might think because I'm a pastor and I preach that I know about such things, and I do know about such things. But I know is that it's easier to talk about how God showed up, past tense, than it is to talk about how God is showing up, present tense. And I think that's what made Oh God work. The premise that God wants to be a part of our lives, every moment of every day, and to show the world that God was still wanting to be engaged, he chose a guy stocking produce who hadn't been to church in years. The Israelites, those born into slavery in Egypt, had endured bondage for more than 210 years before Moses showed up. He was an interesting guy to be chosen as the deliverer of the people of Israel because he himself had been raised in the household of the oppressors. It's thought that tattooed on his arms was the crest of his father, the Pharaoh. So you might remember the story of Moses, maybe not, but you know, as a baby, he was drawn out of the Nile River by the Pharaoh's daughter. And so there he stood in his growing up years, in his teen years, in the years of his young adulthood. He stood next to Pharaoh, Seti II, while the Hebrew people were burdened and abused. So in Exodus 17, we move deep into the story of Moses after his spiritual awakening and after he lays claim to the birthright of his ethnicity. There were plagues that tortured the Egyptians. There was this crescendo that led the slaves out of Egypt to into the face of freedom through the Red Sea. But freedom has a cost that ought never be trivialized. It's not like you can change your clothes and forget the trauma. I mean, we actually know that now, even if they didn't know that then. So these folks had followed Moses through the Red Sea, and they had passed safely to the other side. And the very next day, Miriam, who is the birth sister of Moses, you know, the one who floated him down the Nile and into the pathway of the daughter of Pharaoh, who would nurture him in his growing up and his life. I went to look up her name because I like those kind of details, and I couldn't quite think of it. And then I discovered that in Scripture, the name of Pharaoh's daughter is never given. Tradition gives her a name, but Scripture does not. And I'll be pondering that for a while after the sermon. So they go across the Red Sea, part the Red Sea, and on the other side of it, Miriam, 7 years older than Moses, starts singing. You can read that in Scripture, and everybody joins in the dance, and everybody seems happy. And the very next day, they begin to ask the question, is God with us now? Because you can see that it's easier to feel and believe and know and see where God was than it is to believe and see and feel that God is. So first things first, the water was nasty. So they complained to Moses, and Moses took their issue to God, and God purified the water. And then they were hungry. So they complained to Moses, and Moses took the complaint to God, and God provided manna, which is kind of this sticky substance, we think, that evaporated as the day went on. But first thing in the morning, it was plentiful, and it was something that could be eaten. I want to suggest this morning that deep down in every moan of distress was this question: is God with us now? Is God in this with us now? We know God brought us out of slavery, but is God here now? So according to the scholars who focus on the Hebrew scripture, specifically in this 17th chapter of Exodus, the people are frustrated, and so they approach Moses with the challenge. Call God out, they say in chapter 17. Call God out, and we'll ask God for ourselves. All these years of preaching, and I find this scene very problematic. I find myself wondering, what do they want from Moses? All Moses has done is give up everything in his life to be in this moment. He allowed his eyes to be open to things he never knew existed, to a truth that existed for a whole nother ethnicity of people. And once you've had your eyes open to the abuse endured by others, you can't close them again. You can't unsee what you've seen. So today I find myself wondering about the tattoos that Moses had. And I'm wondering if every time he stood up in front of the people and they caught a glimpse of those Pharaoh emblem tattoos, if maybe they weren't themselves a little bit traumatized, re-traumatized by the memory of the generations of people whose basic needs were ignored. And I wonder if you're hungry and you're thirsty and you're lost in the wilderness, if you might just wonder what motivates the guy who's leading the pack. Maybe he's not any better than his dad. Maybe he's got no agenda higher than his dad's agenda, the oppressor that you left. And in that thought, I find that I am no longer so mad at them for whining. I'm not shaking my head because they want to make sure that God is still there. Is God in this hard moment? And is God willing to prove that to us again? See, I think perhaps they were not questioning God's existence. They were questioning God's presence. So can you hear the difference in that? I mean, it might be the only thing I say that's worthwhile this morning. That maybe the Israelites give us an opportunity to acknowledge the existence of God. We know there is God. But maybe their moaning and groaning provides us an opportunity to acknowledge that sometimes we wonder where God is. Is God present with us in this very moment? See, I think we know something about that kind of question. It's always clearer to see where God was. So in the firefighter who showed up just in time to save a burning building because a candle got out of line. Or you hear the stories about a runner in a marathon race who drops of a heart attack and a doctor that's right behind him who saves the life. I'm hearing now about rescue dogs and cats who come into a person's life at just the right time to pull them out of depression, or a friend who writes a letter that arrives to you on the very day you need somebody to say, I love you. Now, come on, you could add to my litany this morning, right? And if you were here with me, I might even ask you to say it out loud. I wouldn't be upset with you if you paused me for a moment and turned to somebody, even if it's just to your pet, and say, I had this God moment. I knew these moments when God was just all over. But the moments that are God don't stop us from asking, is God here now? They don't stop us from lamenting in the hard places. So Moses picks up his staff, you know, the staff that turned the Nile River into blood, and the staff that called down the plagues, and the staff that parted the Red Sea. He did what God told him to do. He picked up the staff and he hit it against the rock. And fresh water came tumbling down. And the people got an answer to the question, is God here now? Yes, God is here now, loving and caring with a deeper patience that you can imagine. In Christian thought, we hold the Old Testament as a place that is foundational in our understanding of Jesus, who is the Christ. In these verses from Exodus, the people need to express their deepest fears, and God steps up through Moses. When Moses marks the journey that will ultimately be 40 years in the wilderness, he names every spot where they stop. And this spot, the hitting of the rock spot, right near Mount Sinai, he calls that place Meribah, which means this is where the people wondered if God still was. He didn't name the places for the miracles that happened there. You have to dig into Scripture to find those. If you just look at a map, you'll find the places based on the deepest faith questions of the people. That's how they were named. Now, if I were going to name that spot, I might name it Home Run, because I rather think that in this Scripture, God hit it out of the park. Embracing the people, providing for their needs, and continuing to go on before them, come up after them, and walk right alongside them. So there's this final scene in the movie, Oh God, where George Burns finds himself in a courtroom being put on trial. Does God exist? And his final monologue happens when he steps out of the witness box, takes a couple of steps, and disappears. And so it's his disembodied voice that offers this final word. He says to the courtroom, and this is 1977, "I know how hard it is in these times to have faith, but maybe if you could have the faith to start with, maybe the times would change. You could change them. Think about that. Try not to hurt each other. There's been enough of that. And it really gets in the way. I'm a God of very few words. So hear this. However hopeless, helpless, mixed up, and scary it all gets, it can work. If you find it hard to believe in me, maybe it would help you to know that I believe in you." Now, isn't that something? We serve a God who believes in us. Let us pray. Gracious God, so many years ago when the Apostle Paul wrote his letter to the people in Philippi, he reminded them that in their darkest moments, you still are. You still were, and you intend to be. He said to the people, "The Lord is near." So celebrate God all day, every day. Don't fret or worry. Tell God about your life, and before you know it, you will feel whole. He suggested to the people in that letter that if they could share all of their worry and concern with Jesus, that Jesus could replace, that Holy Spirit could replace the place in them that felt afraid. We keep every day putting one foot in front of the other, and we bid farewell to people who die, and we hold in prayer those who are ill or sick or receiving difficult diagnoses. And we take a deep breath and pray for the children and their teachers who are trying a new way of learning. And we shake our head at the thought that we can't be back together in worship because as of now, 200,000 people have died of this COVID-19. So we get up and we put one foot in front of the other. And so on mornings like this, when the Scripture invites us to walk alongside a people who knew themselves to be in the wilderness, who had experienced you over and over and over again, and we know their history, and we know they will continue to experience you over and over and over again. And this morning, we find our hope there. We find our hope in the understanding that you have great patience with us, that while we get on our own nerves, you're still saying, "I'm right here." So today we're going to glory in that. Today we're going to say thank you for that. Today we're going to remember what it feels like to be among those whom we love without restriction. And we're going to hold on to the knowledge that that will be again. And it may not be today or tomorrow, but in the meantime, we can take moments in these hard places, O God, to praise your name, to lament our circumstance, to complain about the situation, to wonder aloud to you, are you still here? And what we'll ask, O God, is that in the question, you will hear our affirmation of faith. Because if we didn't believe in you, we wouldn't have a reason to ask the question. So come among us this day, O God. Come among us in at least one way that we cannot miss. Hear us as we raise our voices to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, go in peace with the love of God, the patience of God, and the hope of Jesus surrounding you in these days. And I'll see you again next Sunday.